share it? All right, everyone, thanks for coming. We're about to begin.
Coming this May to Frontline.
My name's Ed Snowden. The NSA specifically targets the communications of everyone. It ingests them by default.
The National Security Agency called it the program.
He said, we are under emergency conditions.
Created after 9/11.
Extraordinary means are required to deal with a threat. And then he said, don't ask any more questions.
Collecting data on American citizens.
Anything you hand to a private company is potentially government's.
You're looking for unknown conspirators, and the way they devised to do that was to look at everybody.
This May, Frontline tells the story of secrets at the highest levels of government.
A whole new surveillance program without warrants.
Designed for domestic surveillance.
What we're doing is lawful, and I think is effective.
Through two presidencies.
George Bush is on the edge of a cliff.
This is a highly classified program that is crucial to our national security.
He wasn't just collecting phone calls, he was collecting the entire internet stream.
No more ignoring the law when it is inconvenient.
Obama not only continued, but expanded these programs beyond what the Bush administration did.
Leaks.
The one final choice was to go to the press.
They leak classified information. That's against the law.
The New York Times began to realize they'd been lied to by the White House.
Whistleblowers.
Here is this low-level analyst who was able to access 1.7 million documents.
This was a stupendous intelligence breach.
Every intelligence agency in the world is trying to find this guy, find Snowden.
And a challenge to the Constitution.
That's not just innocent data collection. That's digital surveillance.
I argued it was unethical, illegal, and unconstitutional. And when this comes out, all hell is going to break loose.
From Frontline's award-winning investigative teams.
I truly had become an enemy of the state.
A chilling series.
You will have blood on your hands if there's another attack.
About the convergence of government spying.
If the NSA officials are breaking the law, I am gonna fry them.
And an information revolution.
We're living behind one of the mirrors. Corporate America and national security state know so much about us. We know so little about them.
Frontline special series beginning May 13th, only on PBS.
A few years ago, Washington's oyster industry nearly collapsed, exposing a haunting truth about the world's oceans. Carbon dioxide was corroding the seas far faster than once thought. That was just the beginning.
I don't think society understands the impacts it has. They think ocean acidification, you know, no big deal. What can we do about it?
Coral reefs are losing their diversity. They're losing their structure, their quality of habitat for all the crabs and shrimps and sea stars that are living on coral reefs.
Ditemui kalau tidak ada juga ya ada juga kita makan satu hari ada juga kalau ada hasil kalau tidak ada itu dia tidak lagi kita makan.
If we don't do something now, we're going to wind up being on a trajectory that is really probably going to have some strong negative consequences across the entire world.
It was an entirely different life, and I don't think Detroit will ever be the same way again.
And nobody that I knew of thought that this place would last this long, another 60 years after it was closed.
The ornate ceilings and the polished marble floors and the grand staircase. Just basically totally destroyed. You kind of just want to see it demolished rather than see it in the condition it's in.
I mean, look at it. It's amazing, you know? Words can't even describe how great it is. You could spend weeks here and not even see all of it.
You know, I know that people throughout the world think that this is really incredible and it's art. And we can appreciate that, but people also have to understand that it's a threat. It's an immediate and imminent threat. To public safety.
I don't know, what can I say? It's pretty depressing.
Well, here's the thing about the Packer plant. It's real simple. You either love it or you hate it.
I want this year to be great. I want a state championship, go undefeated, get defensive player of the year. I want it to be like, wow, remember when we did this our senior year? That's what I mean by great.
I want this year to be a year when a lot of dreams are realized.
This is his last year being a kid, and everything after this year is gonna be business for him.
If he wants to be the best, then I want him to be the best.
I want this year to be a breakout year for Deshaun.
Break records, every record there is.
And I want to win the big ballgame.
Kid has really put it all together.
Always behind him 100%.
You know, it's my only shot at being a first-time head coach.
I want to be the best defensive end
in college and hopefully into the pros.
As the number one prospect in the country,
Alabama, Florida might have the edge.
I think Michigan has a great shot.
Is he Big Ten bound?
He likes to keep everyone in suspense.
Barricade. It's like a post-apocalyptic nightmare down here. It's insane. There's a man behind me, half naked, wielding a chainsaw. Whoa. They're just ready for a fight. They're waiting for the police to push forward. It's been fighting like this for 5 days now. Welcome to Kiev.
I'd like to now invite our esteemed panelists to come join me on stage, whose work you just saw, and we're going to have a nice discussion about the future of video journalism. So can you guys join me up here, and I'll make proper introductions. Yeah. Well, you guys are all esteemed. Yeah. They're all, wait, who are? happy Monday, everyone. Thanks for coming. Appreciate you guys showing up. Before I get into this panel, and I'll make my comments very, very short, I just want to talk a little bit about what brings us here tonight. This is the culminating event for a report that several of us have been working on called Video Now. Sometime last summer, Emily Bell, the head of the Tau Center, Taylor Owen, the head of research at Tau Center, and I were sitting around and we were talking about the reports. And I'm a video guy, and interestingly enough, there had been no video reports done, or done reports about the video industry. There'd been a lot of conjecture. There'd been a lot of talk about how popular video is, how important video is, how it would be the holy grail or the savior of video journalism, and yet no one really knew what people were doing. So with the generous funding from the Tau Foundation and the Knight Foundation, they set me off on the road. But before that, I had to find a place to go, or places to go. So with the help of some fine folks I'll introduce in a minute, we called about 125 news publications just to see what they were doing. And these publications range from digital startups to newspapers to magazines, anyone who had you know, uploaded a video somewhere and was trying to make a buck off of it. So we called them up, and we had three questions we were really interested in. And which was, first, how did they define video? You know, video is video, those cat videos that, you know, everyone loves to share. Is it, you know, the United States of Secrets, which is a 3-hour part series? You know, how do you define video? So that was the first question we wanted to ask, because up to this point, you know, if you grew up in the generation I grew up in, you grew up with, you know, Dan Rather in the evening news, you kind of knew what video journalism was, but that was different now. The second question was, like, how did you make, or how do you make this video? And what I mean by that, you know, who are your teams? You know, my version of a producer, is that your version of a producer? Do you guys have big teams? Do you have one-man bands? Do reporters shoot with iPhones? So we really wanted to know how the sausage was made, essentially. And the third, which was a harder question, was, are you making any money? And this is obviously the big question for the industry, and it should be a big question for journalists, because if they don't make money, then you don't get jobs, right? And so that was a huge question for us to answer. And so out of the 125 places we called, we invited about 50 to participate in this report. And here was the gotcha about the report. It would be on camera. And so if any of you, I see a lot of familiar video faces in here. So you know the difference between doing a print story and a video story, right? There's a whole level of access you have to gain. So out of those 50, they very politely said, oh, we would love to. Wait, cameras? And so they would no longer love to, except for a handful of really brave, honest folks who were, A, interested in what the industry was doing, but also really interested in giving back and giving us a sense of how things were being done. And five of those fine folks are here tonight. And we're going to have a nice conversation with that. But before we do, I just wanted some special thanks, because a night like this doesn't come along every, you know, all that often. And I want to thank some people for putting it together. Of course, Emily Bell, Taylor Owen, and Lauren Mack. Lauren, without Lauren, none of this would have happened. So thank you very much to everyone at the Tau Center. Of course, our funders, the Tau Foundation, the Knight Foundation. Deans Call and Gruskin, always very supportive of this type of work and this type of research, allowing us to do this kind of stuff, and five really, really special people. If you could kind of raise your hand if you're not too shy. Jika Gonzalez, right here, Jika. Juanita Ceballos, there they are. They're all clustered together, of course they are. Adam Perez, and Jennifer Dev. So for those of you who don't know, they're here as the DMAs that work here, but also, they were the poor souls who had to jump in and make those calls to a lot of companies to say, hey, what's your traffic like? How much money do you make? And so they were invaluable in terms of the research. But a very special thanks to my co-conspirator, my you know, partner in arms here, Abby Atkinson, right here, who's the producer on the, you stand up, Abby, on the report. She endured flights and missed flights and late stuff, you know, a lot of stuff and long nights of editing to put this together. So truly, this was a team effort, and I can't thank her enough for that. But now to our esteemed guest here. Now this truly, I keep on saying this report would not be done without, but truly this report would not be done without these five fine folks here. When you try to go into someone's workplace, and you know, as journalists, we try to do that, we try to find out information, but it's really weird when you're a reporter reporting on reporters, right? I was immediately terrified. I was like, that's an instant fact check, right? The second I leave, I'm gonna get fact checked up and down. But these five folks were open and honest and really have done even more than they could probably consider in terms of contributing to the industry. We're often hesitant to give you know, to talk about what we do, talk about successful strategies, talk about what doesn't work. And without these five panelists next to me, I think we would be much lesser for it. So without further ado, I'll let them talk about what they do. But to my immediate left is Rainey Aronson. She's the deputy executive producer of Frontline. Next to hers, Danny Galowski, a photo video editor at the Seattle Times. We'll save applause all at the end. Wow, you guys lined up in correct order. Okay.
We are esteemed.
You can read your cards, right?
We can read our name tags.
Next, and Danny traveled very far and he has a newborn, so special thanks for him for coming all this way. Next to him is Kathy Kalishevsky, director of photo and video for the Detroit Free Press. Next to her is Jason Mojica, editor-in-chief of Vice News. And finally at the end is Andy Pergam. Andy, up until about 3 weeks ago, is correct, was the head of video at Washington Post. So because he's no longer there, he could probably give us more juicy tidbits, right? But now Andy is a consultant and also working with the McClatchy Group of newspapers. Is that correct?
Yep.
Okay, great. So I'm gonna sit down now. So the format of this, as I wrote to them, is, you know, I've never done a panel before. I've sat on panels. I don't know how to moderate very well, so I thought, let other people talk. So I posed this as a really cool dinner table conversation with five really smart people. So that's what we're going to do here. But I'm just going to start off the conversation here. One of the immediate questions that we asked, and we came into your newsrooms, and we did the report, and we asked, you know, how do you guys define video? There's a lot of talk about it. When the average show goes onto YouTube, they may be looking at a Vice video, or they may be looking at cats twirling around on a fan. So how do you guys approach video journalism in your newsroom? Is there a length? Is there a topic? Is there a direction? How do you guys do what you do? And I'll start with United States right here of Secrets.
Oh, that's me, United States of Secrets? No. I mean, Frontline's a bit different in the sense that we are video. So, I mean, we're really the legacy of Frontline is 30 years of doing really strong documentary films. I think our main goal is to tell really amazing stories in visual form. And so when I think about video, I don't even think about video per se. I think about what we really do, and we do it throughout our whole news organization, from the work that we're now doing digitally increasingly, and also what we call our broadcast, which is really also stream, so it's really the same thing after all, right? So, and that's what I want to talk about a bit tonight, is how our worlds are increasingly colliding, and I think a lot of us could talk about that now, that the divisions that were here just a couple of years ago don't exist anymore, or at least we're consciously breaking those walls down. And so we call video Frontline. That's what we do. We're visual first.
Okay, great. And how about you newspaper folks who have this burden of being in a news, well, not a burden, burden. I love newspapers. this wonderful opportunity.
Oh, the bias.
Yeah.
I'm going to sit with you.
This is the part of the dinner table.
So jump right in. How do you guys define it?
I think being at a newspaper is a really great opportunity because we can be really picky and choosy. We have to be. We have pretty small video resources. Mm-hmm. And so we sort of get to go around and pick the best stories that we think, out of the stories that we're producing, we get to choose the stories we think are best tuned for video. And because video is a part of the story, it's really liberating because I don't think that we need to put every single part of the story into the video. So it allows us to tell the part of the story that's best suited for video because it's really just a part of the audience experience.
What he said. No, I mean, it's one of those things where, but to that though, there's an increased pressure to do video with everything, you know, and it's this constant education and this constant dialogue about, you know, what makes a good video and when will we exercise, you know, that opportunity and use those resources for that, and when will we not? I mean, and it's much harder to say no than it is to say yes. And so, you know, somebody comes up to me and asks me, hey, we want to do video with X. You know, I have a whole litany of questions that I kind of like, okay, well, what's going on? Who are the characters? Are there moments? Is it emotional? You know, would you watch it if you, you know, stumbled on it online? Those types of things, you know, just, is there a narrative? Do we have access? How much time? When's the deadline? I mean, all these things have to come into play because they'll say, I want to do video. Well, what type of video do you want to do? Do you want to tell a story? Do you want to do a clip? Do you want to do a stand-up like a news, TV news guy? What do you want to do? And so it's really trying to educate people who aren't necessarily video literate or visually literate as to what it is they want, you know, from video.
When you say they, the reporters in the newsroom?
The reporters and the editors, you know, I mean, we, like Danny, we get to make some choices in our department about what we're going to spend real quality time on, and the stuff that isn't worth kind of the visual experts' time. And that sounds terrible, but it's, if a reporter wants to shoot a soundbite of, you know, Alan Mulally, CEO of Ford, talking at a, you know, shareholders thing, have at it. You know, we're going to do something else. So,
And it is an education because a lot of our reporting staff doesn't come from a standard video education. And so it's been an ongoing education as we've been moving into this direction.
So Andy, you just came from Washington Post. You guys are huge, Post TV. Mm-hmm. Talk about this pressure because I hear it all the time. Video, 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 and, sure. And it stops at that, right? Video,
right.
Period. So talk about that pressure and how you guys dealt with it.
Yeah, and I think a lot of people say video, video, video without really, like you're saying, sort of dive into some of the real questions of, well, does this make sense and what would it look like? And I think just saying video, yes, that's not a strategy. Like we need to actually be more comfortable saying, no, that's not gonna be a good video for us. And so at the Post, you know, the Post has a legacy of more than, you know, 15, 16 years of doing high quality, long form video journalism. That's, you know, what the Post is known for. And there's a desire to do things that are even shorter, that just make sense, you know, financially, journalistically, you name it. And it's being strategic about choosing, these are the types of things we're gonna do and these are not the types of things we're gonna do. That's important. And I think where newspapers have a great advantage is, first of all, newspapers still have lots of boots on the ground, lots of reporters, lots of people on the street, which is terrific. Newspapers are also really good at explaining things. And so if you think about it as telling a story, that's relatively key. The other big important thing, I think, is that literacy is just as editors have decided for years, that's not a 10,000 word story, that's a 200 word brief. We have to be more comfortable saying, well, that's an amazing documentary style video, we're gonna do that, or no, that's a 90 second explainer that just, you know, illuminates some piece of a broader story. And I think a lot of that comes from editors just getting a better understanding of what video is these days.
Great, well, let me jump into, let Jason jump into the fold. These are all established news organizations, and Vice was making a lot of money doing the Vice thing, right? And then you guys up and decided to start a news channel when every headline has been saying news is losing, right? So what were you guys thinking? And then, you know, and what is your strategy in entering this space right now?
Well, the secret is that we've actually figured out how to monetize news, and of course, we're not gonna share that secret. So
but it'll stay in this room, I promise.
Right. But I mean, yeah, I think Vice and video really kind of stemmed out of something where, I mean, Vice started as a magazine in 1994 in Canada, and it's, you know, jump into video was in places where it made sense to, where video could actually add something. It was, you know, someone looking at Vice articles and saying, if only there was a camera running when this thing happened, that would be gold. So to that end, you know, we decide to shoot video instead of doing long form written journalism when it makes sense, when there's value added there, you know, otherwise it's those situations where, you know, you have basically someone standing in front of a green screen, basically reading a carefully rewritten AP Wire story that's, you know, and that's basically of value for about 1 hour. And we see that a lot. But to the point of, you know, newspapers doing video, I remember as a consumer watching that transition, and it was very interesting to me because I remember looking at it and saying, oh, this is like newspaper men doing video. It's an inverted pyramid style. It's the important information at the beginning, and then you can keep watching, but you don't really have to. You can just kind of like get out somewhere about the halfway mark. But yeah, it's been interesting to watch newspapers develop that skill that I think we've been pretty good at so far.
So to Jason and Rainey here, you guys work in long form, and the adage since the internet has been around is that people won't watch long form. There's no way. No one's staying around for more than 60 seconds. What is your thoughts on that? What have you seen? And more importantly, young kids don't like important stories like Ukraine, and they don't like important stories like North Korea. What has been your experience with that, and how are you addressing a younger population?
I'll take part of this, and then Jason, just cut in, because I'd love to hear what you have to say, too. I mean, I think people will watch good long form. I don't ever think that you could just do long form, especially in the digital space, and get away with anything that isn't really good, and I mean really well told and taught and really should be long form. So Frontline, when we're moving into the digital space, we're making decisions at all times about what the authentic length of a piece should be, and we're brave. We think some stories really should be long, some stories should be short. And when you're a good storyteller and you have great editors and you have great storytellers who know how to tell a great film, great story, usually people will come to us, and that's what we've found. So the more aggressively we move into different arenas, you know, certainly short form for us is a lot longer than most people, right? So our broadcast, the quote unquote broadcast, is still in the 50-minute range. So short form to us is sort of 10 to 20 minutes, and people love that too. So the other thing we've noticed about our audience is that it is totally exploding online right now, especially when people have a tablet. So we believe that the tablet for Frontline is actually the most natural space of all. In fact, I think it's as natural as television to us, because we have so much we want to embroider and do around the films and for the films, and we love to break things apart. And so that audience is exploding, and they're younger. They're a lot younger.
Just to clarify, tablet specifically, not computer.
Right, well, computer people come to us too, but they watch for less time. So when we do the audience data online, people will stay anywhere from like 2 to 7 minutes in our films, and they'll dive in and out of it. People on the tablet will watch sometimes 3 times that, and then they come back to watch the end of the film. So we can really see a huge shift to people leaning back, watching films. I mean, people are seeing this across the board with documentary. But again, I mean, our challenge is to be better all the time and work with people who have contemporary filmmaking language. That's another thing that's changing. I think that we learn a lot from younger people all the time about that, and Frontline's basically an open forum in that way. But our audience is growing, and young people, I don't believe they're not into news. I think that's crazy, by the way. I think that Vice, Policy Mike, these places are proving otherwise, and even in our arena, we're proving otherwise, that younger people are coming to us increasingly. I mean, it's kind of amazing. We can get into the numbers if you're curious.
Yes, we are. But Jason, how are you guys approaching that? You know, when you guys went onto YouTube, your huge YouTube presence, and YouTube's always been about the little snackable things. So,
sure. I think early on when we launched the Vice YouTube channel, we made some mistakes in that we thought that maybe they knew something that we didn't, and that sounds incredibly cocky. But what I mean is that, you know, the wisdom of the internet was that, you know, people wanted short little snackable videos, 3 minutes, lots of cats, things of that nature. And don't get us wrong, we have actually made a full feature-length film about internet cats. So, you know, so I guess they were right about that. But in general, when we started trying to adapt to what we thought was the language of YouTube, the people who've been following Vice for years, kind of, there was this incredible backlash against everything we were doing, just saying, basically, what is this bullshit, and where are the long form docs? Give me the Congo docs and things like that. So then we just kind of started feeding these, you know, hour long documentaries onto YouTube, and they ended up doing incredibly well. They were viewed hundreds of thousands of times. There was an incredible completion rate, you know, for these hour-long docs. And so it turned out, I mean, I'm sure it works for, you know, dancing hamsters and things like that. But that they, you know, I think YouTube realized that they were missing an important market for, that people did have an appetite for long-form documentary, and that, you know, middle managers across America were not very observant, and people did have time during the middle of the day to watch hour-long documentaries on important subjects.
So Danny and Kathy, and I hate to lump you guys, but you work in a similar space. You have limited resources, as you mentioned, and how do you guys, you know, we've talked about what works and, you know, good story, but specifically, how do you guys decide what gets your resources? It's very finite, it's very limited. What type of stories will get your resources, and how do you kind of divvy up your staff to do certain projects?
Usually it's, am I interested in it, is usually how I decide. No.
Well, you get to do that if you're the editor.
Yeah.
See, that's a good answer. Yeah. That's true.
We have 12 photographers on staff. And like I said earlier, you know, there's a pressure to do a lot. And so we really do rely on our reporting staff to kind of fill in where I think it's the feed the beast, you know, do what you have to do so you can do what you want to do. I mean, that's always been my mantra at the paper. If you're fitting the need or filling the need, or they're not asking me to do it for a lot of video for no reason. I mean, they're looking at the numbers, they're looking at statistics, they're looking at surveys, and they're looking at advertisers, and yeah, I get it, you know, they want to make money. And so they're asking us to do a lot of video. I don't know, and like, if you watch me in the Tau Center thing, I was like, well, when I see it, I'll believe it. But is that good journalism all the time in terms of video journalism? And so what we try to do with the 12 staffers that we have, I would say 3 or 4 of them are about 80, 90% video stills on days when we need somebody to fill in. I have one guy who's just 100% video. And then the rest kind of do it as we see fit in terms of the story. And we really do think if I would watch this, if it's got a great character, if it's got really great news value that kind of transcends the everyday news. You know, we had a turkey that wouldn't let a woman out of her house. You know, that's like, why would you not go do video of the turkey that won't let the lady out of the house? But then there's also, you know, the fireman that on off duty ran into the house and saved a family as he was driving by. Well, of course I want to hear what happened there, so I'm going to say, yes, please shoot video with that. But, I mean, the long form stuff is the stuff that I'm drawn to, and I'll usually say yes to any really good story that somebody wants to do a long form. I'll be like, yeah, we'll do that, you know, and then we'll try to make it work.
I have a question, mm-hmm. both for Du or any of the newspaper folks. I mean, who's the genius who decided that video was the future? I mean, because it is the most resource-intensive, laborious.
Right.
I mean, it's resource-intensive, it's laborious, it doesn't actually get as many views as you want it to. I'm just curious.
Some dude in some advertising office somewhere.
Right. I mean, is it because some perceived idea that there was going to be money in it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That,
okay. Yeah, the actual idea that there's money in it. Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
Danny, answer that, but let's break it down. Give us some real numbers, right? There are real numbers that appear in the report. There's this, you know, this magical unicorn, right, called video that will pay for everything. What kind of numbers do you get on an average video? And how much money are we bringing in if this is going to be the answer?
Well, I'm going to back up, though, to answer you first. Mm-hmm. For me, it's not a business office. It's an audience expectation. Mm-hmm. I know that my audience gets online to watch video, mm-hmm. and I know that video helps my storytelling. And so I'm going to back up and answer this mm-hmm. question, too. For when I choose to approach video on something, I'm looking for something that carries emotion or helps our audience get an experience. What I don't want is, I don't want a video that tells the same story as the text. I want a video that helps you understand the story in a way that the text doesn't, in a way that the photo gallery doesn't, and in the way that the graphics doesn't. And I think that if our audience member comes to our story, reads the text, understands it one way, ingests the graphic, gets it one way, mm-hmm. And then the photo gallery and the video, if they can all tell a slightly different story that helps your overall understanding, that's how I judge success. As for sheer numbers.
Yeah, I mean, you know, that's been the talk, right? That video will you know, save a lot of places. So what kind of numbers are we talking about?
I'm gonna also not answer your numbers question. And instead, add on to that you know, I think when newspapers started adding photography back in the day, it wasn't because, ooh, we think someone's gonna click through page view, you know, galleries, and we're gonna get all these page views off of it. It was because it really helped illustrate that story. And I think in the same way, video does that, and it's an important part of what we're doing. And I think that the reason there is this push, not only is there the high CPMs, which is important, but I think there's also an understanding that, hey, our organizations, which are often leading in our markets as the top news website, they need to be multidimensional. They need to add this more visual component to it.
Right, but both of those answers are very good answers, and you are esteemed, so therefore I expect you to have those answers. But don't you feel like perhaps your lesser competitors are getting only this surface level of that message, which is they're not hearing the, oh yeah, it really helps storytelling. They're just like, oh, there's money in it. So yeah. We need to have video. It kind of goes back to, we need a website. Like in the mid 90s, like, yeah, we need a website. Okay, I used to design websites. So you go to a client and then you say, okay, I can do a website for you. They're like, great. Here's how much will it be? $2,000. Great. So what do you want it to say? And they're like, what do you mean? Like, I was like, well, I don't know. I need, it's your company. What do you want it to say? What do you want it to be like? And they're like, I don't know. You're supposed to make a website for me. So I hear I need a website.
And so I think that's our job, though. So if somebody shows up into our newsroom and is just like, we need video. And I'm ready to be like, okay, this is the video we're going to do.
Right.
And to me, the answer to that is also that what you need to do is video that is authentic to your organization. So mm-hmm. when Frontline starts doing 30-second hamsters on wheels videos, well, that'll be a terrible
as
day.
As long, you know, as they have the narrator, I forget his name.
I mean, Will might do it.
I would want
like that to me is most important, is figuring out what your voice is, and therefore what specific part of the industry you want to do. And I think mm-hmm. there's been a lot of experimentation because a lot of things haven't worked. And so right. we try all sorts of things, and then we go in the direction that we've seen that seems to work the best.
Yeah.
And I think in my mind, it's still so nascent. It's still the early days that we're still figuring it out.
That's a term I hear a lot, what works. So I will talk numbers because I've done the research, right? And if you go to Taos, videonow.taoscenter.org, you can watch the full report. But a lot of places we went to, not esteemed places, but a lot of places we went
to,
an average video can get anywhere between 500 and 1,000 views, right? You put that up. That was a common number that we heard. And so if you do the math on that, Andy said the term CPM, that's a cost per 1,000, right? So if an advertiser gives you $20 CPM, which is a generous rate, right, for video,
yeah,
you're making about 10 bucks for that video. So the economy doesn't really work there.
Right.
So what do you mean by work? If it's not the money that's working, what is working? I hear that a lot. What's working for you?
I mean, so we're different because we're nonprofit. So mm-hmm. public television is different. Public media is different. But for us, what's working is just building an audience that's vital, that will support, at this point, local stations that then give membership money to the stations to support Frontline. So it's a really complicated and very different system than most people are operating in. But the most important thing for Frontline is this online audience. So we're video first, right? We're film first. But I mean, the people who come to us online and the people who come to us in social, they're actual people, unlike the broadcast, you know, the ephemeral people who watch us on the broadcast. So we pay attention to this group because we care a lot about them, and we care about fostering the conversation with them that, frankly, we've never had with our audience. So we have a different basis on what works, you know, and frankly, we have another whole basis on what works, which is the journalism penetrating the conversation? Is it actually part of the conversation? Are we changing anything? Is it making any difference? So that's also it's a different metric for us. So we are in a different space, but we still need to have people watching us and caring about us and engaged. So it's different.
How about you guys? Where you know, if it's not the money, if it's what is working for you mean?
Yeah.
Well, I might just also say that we're not that far different when it comes to audience, because we are a subscription-based.
Right, I think that's true, right. So membership, subscription, it's similar, right.
Yeah, and if our audience wants this, then we should provide it. So there is a little bit of that. But I also think that if we spend a whole lot of time on a really big project that we really care about, if we were just to throw it out there and see what happened, right, I think that we'd be failing our audience. But if we can do a really good video piece that helps people make an emotional connection to that story and dive deeper into the text and deeper into the story overall, I would consider that success.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And I would just say from the business,
go ahead.
Okay, I was just gonna say, the business side is pretty important in all this, and I think actually CPMs are generally higher for some premium publishers than $20 CPMs.
Esteemed publishers.
I'm not going to name names. Yeah, and I think some of the views are actually higher than that for a lot of publishers too. But there's something about seeing the immediate sort of reaction and knowing that people are watching this. And when you see one of those videos, that's when you're doing it right, and that's when clearly there's an interest in it or a need. And that if that to me is the best indicator of this is what our audiences want, and that's the most important key.
And I would echo what Danny was saying about, you really, every story has a different way that it can be told. You know, some stories are best told with video, some stories are best told through words. And, you know, sometimes it's an interactive timeline a photo gallery or a photo or a picture story. So, it's really looking at the story and saying, what suits this particular story? And then going out and doing that. I do think that people are responding to the emotional, they're responding to the added value of that video can bring to a newspaper story in particular, because we do have all of these different kind of elements that are going on in that website. And
And we're doing the inverse at Frontline. I love listening to these guys because, a lot of our discussion is, so is everything video for us, or do we now move into text? And we have a number of digital reporters now who are writing. And so it's really a great challenge to us is that we're doing the reverse engineering, actually, to say, we should have writers. We should have interactive timelines. And so we moved aggressively into that space. And as a consequence, our numbers go up. So. We're doing the same thing. We're just doing it with different lenses on,
different lenses. One of the things we all talked about was the concept of tone. You talked about audience, your online audience, being different than your TV audience. And when we had our discussions, none of what you do online sounds like the TV I watched growing up. And can you talk about tone and why? What's this webby tone and what does that have to do, and is it a prescribed thing or is it an organic thing, and what does it mean to be of the web in a lot of the stuff that you guys are doing? Anyone can take that.
Well, I'll start by saying I'd love to hear what you have to say. And from my perspective, folks like Vice and folks like Now This News, which is another good example, have a real good understanding of who they think their audience is, and so they're producing things in a way that again sort of rings true with their audience, and I have a lot of respect for that. And I think that it's important that you're treating video differently than you do TV. Nobody wants TV on the web. I don't think that generally works on a newspaper site. They certainly do on Frontline, but I don't think that generally works for a newspaper site. And so what I think they want is something that is more intimate, that is, we can get a camera right in someone's face, and you don't see that. You'd follow someone, as they climbed over a fence into a Ukrainian or a Crimean, army base. Like, that's amazing. You don't see that all the time. And so when you're able to have that intimacy and again answer those questions of would you watch it and would you share this with your friends, mm-hmm. like that's when you've, I think, struck gold.
Yeah, I think that's a very interesting point you make about no one wants TV on the web. Because inherently, TV is inherently catering to the lowest common denominator. It's trying to find that special place where we can get everyone. So, I totally lost my train of thought. So to that point, I guess you can be both smarter, you can use bigger words, you can also be sillier at times. I mean, in a sort of gallows, you know, and bring kind of a gallows humor to things, the way that journalists talk when the cameras are off, and make that kind of, I mean, for us, that's part of our style, I suppose, is just kind of like, let's talk about this as we would after we had just finished that story for NBC. You know, so that is part of the approach.
Mm-hmm. We did this really amazing experiment, and I'll just share it with you so you can share it with anyone who's curious about it, where we took a scene from one of our films on Syria. We've done a lot of work on Syria. And we took that scene and we had it in our broadcast, very important film, really important because it was from both sides of the war and it was really important to get in with Assad's regime. It was crucial for us to get that film out. And then we took that same scene, we expanded it because it was an incredible scene. We had our reporter self-narrate it and we opened the scene up just as a scene. And that film, right, and I call it a film because it's righteous. It's like 30 minutes, it's excellent. That alone got 500,000 people to look at it on YouTube. Just the version that we took, an extended scene that was amazing, this was certainly an extraordinary scene, and put it on with a more intimate voice. So our documentary films do fine, actually, and when they're watching it online or in a tablet, but my guess is the more intimate work that we do online with our films and we think differently about them, even more people are going to come, and a different type of person's going to come. I mean, it was amazing to see what happened in that one experiment we did, and we're doing that more and more.
Is that the Ali Lambert
piece? Yeah, yep. Yeah.
It's great.
I mean, it was
piece.
Really, really interesting to do that. Plus, he had done this just in two takes, this one battle scene. So it was one of this extraordinary moments where you see something really happening, and the camera doesn't go down, so you really see it. And so you can't not put that out there. It's too good, and he's a great storyteller. Yeah. So just his voice was amazing. So that was special. But I think it actually speaks to the question of a more intimate voice, a more raw voice, a more, you know, this is what it was like, although I don't believe in not editing. I'm not that person. But I do believe that a more raw voice can sometimes work well.
Right. What about you, you guys, in terms of how did you identify your tone and what is it like?
I mean, we wanted to, I mean, I think we're filling a gap that TV news in our market really doesn't fill. I mean, they're very much just breaking news and kind of that gotcha journalism that's, you know, hidden camera type of thing. And so what we're really trying to do is capture kind of the spirit and the identity of the community that isn't necessarily driven all by news. It's looking at stuff behind the news. And so, you know, when we did a long form about murder called Living with Murder, and you know, TV goes out and this guy dies, and you know, and the next day nobody remembers this guy's name. And we really wanted to look and explore who these people are and how the city of Detroit and many of its residents are indeed living with murder every single day. And so it takes that daily news thing and really kind of tries to humanize it. And I think people respond to that because they can really have then a connection, because we hear all the time, it's all bad news. It's all bad news. Yeah, because there's a lot of bad news. But if you can humanize it, I think there's an opportunity for people to really connect.
And I think that just the freedom of the medium, we don't have to create 6 90-second spots. You know, we could, if a story is better told in 91 seconds, we can tell it in 91 seconds. And if it is better told in 88, we can tell it in 88. And if it should be 4 minutes, we can make it 4 minutes. And so I think that that removes as much of a need for a reporter to sit there and tell you everything that you're about to see, or to maybe filibuster for a little bit. We can get out of the way of the story and allow the story to unfold at what we think is the right rate for it.
I'd like to jump in on that note too. I mean, and that's something we discovered. We just launched Vice News about a month ago, and we never really thought that breaking news was going to be our forte. And you know, Simon, we sent Simon Ostrowski to Crimea, kind of just at the right time. And I think we stumbled upon our way of doing breaking news, which is kind of this kind of more verite style meandering. Let's watch Simon try to figure out what the hell is going on here. And that could be 16 minutes. You know, like, here's Simon's update from today. It's 16 minutes long. Sit down and enjoy the ride. but also the next day there could be nothing. So that he didn't have to, you know, show up for his live spot at 5 p.m. and kind of ramble on about the fact that really nothing happened today. You know, so that I think that's liberating. And also I think it adds a lot to it, basically, because I see, I mean, our approach, we don't really see news as a zero-sum game, and we don't expect you know, Vice News to be the only place you go for news in your day. We expect it to be part of a healthy food pyramid or news pyramid, and so I think you can get a lot out of newspaper reporting and traditional broadcast media, as well as these, you know, 16-minute deep dives into what happened in Donetsk that day.
Yeah, and I guess I would just add that there's also, you know, as much as I said people don't want to watch TV on the web, I'm going to contradict myself and say that there are some things from TV, and I came from TV, a lot of people come from TV, and I have great respect for what goes on TV, but there are some things that you that are so ingrained in TV that actually can work on the web. So the clip we played before, which was from something called First and 17, which was essentially a series where each week we released a new episode. Well, episodic programming is nothing new, right? That everybody watched last night is the new episode of whatever, Mad Men came out. And so what we did there was we were able to sort of start to build up an audience, because in a sense, people are used to doing it that way. They're used to tuning in, and they get excited about it, and it gives you, there is a framework, there's some stuff that we can take from TV and just do differently on the web.
Although, even episodic, I mean, shows like Game of Thrones have really changed the way that we think about episodic programming. Yeah. Well, and it's different when it's news, and it's different when, because I do tune in to see what's happening on in Crimea, but to create a series, you can also release a series.
Yeah, and House of Cards is a great example of that. Like, you can binge the whole thing. That's amazing.
Because I think that you do consume different.
Right.
And I am talking, I am a member of the generation, I'll never own a TV, and I do read the news. I am literate. When we watch our engagement curves, I've never seen a drop off at 90 seconds. And so, I mean, I started this being told constantly, I heard plenty of theories as to why there's this magic length, songs are a magic length, video should be this length, because this is what, I don't know, Moses came down on tablets and told us the story should be. But I've never seen, if a story is good, people will watch it whatever the length is. But if it's poor, they will bail on it whatever the length is. And we've all seen 90-second videos that are way longer than good hour-long videos.
Yeah, exactly.
Jason, just thinking about the episodic nature of things. I mean, for years, Vice has been releasing these long-form documentaries in multiple parts and kind of trained the audience to expect that. And so when we started doing these dispatches that were kind of cut in the field, we sent someone to, you know, Central African Republic, they were shooting that day, they were cutting something, they were compressing to like a very low res and then uploading to us, and we would upload it and people would be like, where's part two? And why don't you upload the whole thing in one time? And it's like this just happened today. So it's going to take a while to kind of like untrain people from that.
Right. So, yeah, no, we're doing the same thing and we get the same kind of feedback. Like, wait, where's the rest of it? It's like, well, that's today from Crimea. What, sorry.
I want to know how it ends. How does this Crimea story end?
I'd love to know. Does anybody know? Because
I'm really invested in these characters.
Let's figure it out.
I do think that is going to be something that we're going to really have to address, is this feeling like they need to see it right away, you know, and understanding that that's not all. I mean, I have a 13-year-old boy who has never had to wait for an episode of X-Files, you know, and I have to say, you know, this to be continued, I had to wait like 6 months before I could see if Mulder died or not. And so this is something that's, I think, going to continue.
Yeah,
we're going to have to keep educating this next generation that, you know, just chill, you know, it'll come.
Oh, my goodness. I don't know if we can do that. I don't know if we can fix that on the panel, but yes. No, I do think that's right. I think, and also for our audience, they're now adjusting. I don't know if you've seen that with yours, but now all of a sudden they get it that what we do sometimes digitally is not going to be a film, you know, and it's okay. They can wait for something bigger down the road, and that, you know, sometimes we will say, here's just a scene from the road. You know, we'll really try to tell them more what it is so that they get it more. And I think that's also really helpful. So usually it's a big production that someday will be a big film. So we're giving them a little bit because it's valid to, it's important to.
So I've stumbled upon a wealth of long form storytellers here, I guess. But so Jason, you guys arguably one of the hotter properties right now. If our career expo was any evidence, poor Jason got mobbed by all of our students looking for non-existing jobs. I'm just kidding, they're hiring.
People can always be fired.
Yeah. So you guys do...
For those watching on the web.
Get back.
You guys are popular, you speak to young folks, you get lots of traffic, but you seem to be covering a lot of conflict, right? But there's a lot in this world that we need to know, we meaning the general audience. How are you going to avoid being the conflict guys, and how are you going to give your audience a larger diet of what they may need to know?
Well, I mean, I think it's a healthy mix. First of all, I think that crisis and conflict is some of the most important stuff to cover. Those are things that start off very small and then quickly get bigger, and then really no, and then everyone's sitting there going, where's Crimea, or things like that, and wait, where's Rwanda, or this genocide has been happening for 100 days, you say, so that stuff I think is incredibly important, and I'm really proud of my bosses for being willing to fund, that coverage. That said, we're with Vice News, we're trying to decidedly spending a lot more time on U.S. stories, things that have, at least in the early days, always been less, not as sexy, because they're just not immediately visual, because most of America looks like a strip mall. You can't just, go to Lexington, Kentucky and go, well, holy shit, we're in Lexington, Kentucky, So you actually have to dig. You have to
dig. Kentuckians in here?
I was just in Kentucky.
He's someone's
right.
Getting hate mail.
Shit, you were in Kentucky.
Right? Is there a delay on the live stream?
I love you.
Sorry,
Kentucky
Jason.
Friends.
I'm sure Al Jazeera America has a bureau in Lexington, Kentucky. They're everywhere. They're the most American network out there right now. What was I saying?
Kentucky.
Something about Lexington.
You're in America.
How are we going to cover other things that we said aside from crisis and conflict? Well, we're trying to, put in the elbow grease that is required. We're trying in investigative reporting. And that's something that we have not done a lot of. We've certainly gone to far-flung places and gone a lot of places that other people are unwilling to go. But now we're doing, kind of the pencil sharpening and deep dive homework as we try to launch our investigative unit, as well as, again, doing more domestic stories and human rights stories and a broad swath.
Although, should you try to be everything? Should any of us try to be everything? Have I ever seen a web browser that only connects to one website? Do I have tab browsing that only opens to one website? That we should do what we do well.
Right.
For us, it's local news.
Yeah, I think a lot of people have the people who lead organizations often have that misperception of we have to do everything for everybody. And that's not how the web works. And so I'm going to go to Vice to watch a particular type of thing. I'm going to go to Frontline to watch a particular type of thing. I'm going to go to the Washington Post to watch a particular type of thing.
Right.
And maybe that's okay. And I think the more that news organizations embrace that idea, the better the product will be too, because you can clearly define, sharpen the pencil.
Sure, but I guess to that end, we also are doing the things that we've always wanted to do. Mm-hmm. So now we have a new opportunity. So we're not going to be covering sports. We're not going to be covering missing Malaysian airliners. We're not going to be covering, that's the thing. News is a very general term for a lot of, general news outlets. So no sports, no entertainment, no celebrities, no, long, boring murder trials, no missing blonde ladies. I think that's our motto officially. Generally, if you're missing, we don't care until you're found.
So let me kind of, piggyback off of that and all of you guys. So talking about, so you can't be all things to all people, but you do have to have a diversity of ideas in the newsroom or your newsrooms. How do you guys deal with a diversity, and you can define diversity any way you want, and specifically as it trickles down to the stories you
decide to do the communities you guys decide to cover, because as Jason aptly put, video is a pain in the ass to do, right? And if you're gonna throw resources on it, how do you decide where to shine that light?
Well, I'll start with the last part, which I think is a great question, which is, I mean, Frontline, we were talking about Frontline the other day, and David Fanning will always say, well, Frontline's like the trouble with. So trouble with what, right? What are we looking at? So usually we found that communities that we report on, domestically or abroad, happen to be diverse communities. They're the communities that need the most help, that have the most trouble with them. And sometimes we look at Wall Street, as you guys know if you watch us, and that's also really important to look at that reporting as well. But like Rape in the Fields and these types of films really does look at communities that don't have a voice, for a better term. I hate that. That sounds really earnest, but it's true. And we do the investigative work to actually crack the story. So we are investigative first. And then in terms of diversity in the newsroom, we have good luck on the digital side, and we're doing a better job of that. And in our producing core, we are as well. And it's an area that we need to continue to work on, in my mind. And it's one I care a lot about. So I think it's a struggle for all news organizations to take seriously, and take it seriously and do it, because it helps us.
Mm-hmm. How about you guys? And that question of diversity in personnel or stories or?
Well, obviously, Detroit is a very diverse place. It's also a very racially divided place. You know, I think we have one of the most diverse photo staffs in the country. All the ones that I had worked at before were a bunch of white dudes and me. And so now, I mean, we've got women and African Americans and Hispanic and gay and lesbian. And so, I mean, we always, when we're out like having dinner or going to the bar, we're like, we look like this weird dysfunctional family. But it's true, and you need that. You need those people in your newsroom that reflect your community so that they, you know, can. One of our photographers, African American man, is now retired, sweet guy named William Archie, you know, went to one of the Western affluent suburbs, and like, not, he had to go shoot a portrait of some lady about some story that, you know, was very kind of just everyday, knocked on her door, she wouldn't let him in, you know, and he was even showing his ID, like, you know, I am William Archie from the Free Press, they told you I was coming to your house to take your picture, yet she wouldn't let him in. I can't relate to that experience. And so when there is other discrimination going on in the community, William can relate to that, and I can't. And so you have to have people that can relate and connect with your community, or you're really just going to fail as a news organization.
It's really key to every hire. It's key to every hire that we make, but let's be honest, we make a lot less hires. Yeah. You know, so I think that, therefore, I think that it's even more important. But I do feel like, at least in my short career, I felt like there was a real push on diversity, and then I think the economic recession happened, and it maybe peeled back a little bit, and we just focused on survival. And then I'm hearing more and more of it again now. And it is, we certainly consider in every hire that we make, and we try to, in our video reporting and in all of our reporting, we try to reflect our community and our community's interests.
So, well, before you guys answer, so, you know, how as you as editors and you know, part of the management, how do you increase that diversity? We've always talked we got to do better, but how do you actually do better, especially with budget cuts? And what are you guys doing?
I mean, I think public media is trying to start an executive actual fellowship program to track people through a different way of getting into places like Frontline, not just Frontline, but Nova and the other big shows. And so to just crack open a space to recruit people and to recruit intentionally for that purpose. And news organizations actually, especially the networks, did a very good job of this. Like, there's a bunch of network people here who could talk better about that than me, where there are actual recruiters who had a specialty in diverse recruiting. And that's how you do it. It's intentional. You don't expect people to just show up. You have to go and look for them too. Because the talent, generally, talented people oftentimes have jobs and they have good jobs. So you have to go intentionally to find them and convince them that they should come work for Frontline. And they ask the toughest of questions. And they should. So that's how we do it.
How about you, gents, at the end, your organizations?
I was just going to add that I don't think it's not just diversity of race and gender, it's also diversity of backgrounds and interests. Mm-hmm. And so when we hired launched Post TV and we hired a bunch of people, we hired a former flight attendant, and we hired a someone who co-authored a book, and we hired someone who was producing a radio show to do TV. So like, and all those people bring really different experiences, and therefore they have just a different lens, and they look for different story ideas. And so the end result is a diversity of the types of things that you wind up covering or that come across your radar, and that's fantastic.
And it is critical. It's really critical. If I had 13 photographers and they all had the exact same interests, I wouldn't be able to cover my community. I don't need 13 sports photographers. I don't need 13 just news photographers. I need 13 people that each have a different skill set and a different background and see different stories.
I mean, my boss, Nancy Andrews, used to say, when we were hiring back 10 years ago when I arrived and we had kind of a flush of hires, and you know, we were looking at some portfolios and the photographers were just coming out of college and they were green, they were really green. And she said, you know, I can train somebody with a little bit of talent to be a better photographer, I can't make them be more interesting person. And I was like, so we were hiring interesting people. Most of them have proven to be, you know, teachable in terms of just bettering their photography skills. They were all interesting people who knew how to tell stories, though.
And Jason, as you guys open up bureaus and staff up, how are you addressing that? You know, you're very, very young newsroom, so that's one way you're leaning. How do you make it a more complete newsroom?
Yeah, well, I mean, first of all, it's balancing young and not as young as well. I mean, you know, there's a lot of value to youth, of course, in terms of hunger and also a sensibility. But also there's something that comes along with having spent years in the game, and those people can kind of inform each other, and that's very valuable. Yeah, in terms of diversity, you know, I don't actively seek out particular ethnic backgrounds or skin colors to balance things out as much as, you know, people with different interests, ideologies. I mean, to all of your points, I mean, it's a bit of making cake is not a good example because you can't bake to taste, but anyway, yeah, I mean, basically every person you add kind of impacts the entire newsroom, and so you have to like kind of assess what that person can bring and how they complement someone else's skills, backgrounds, things like that. In general, I try to look for people who are not me so that I have people to argue with. I have, you know, posh British anarchists, I have middle America, you know, reformed neocons, and that's just, you know, in the New York newsroom. I think, you know, one of the advantages to being an international organization, we have offices in 34 countries, is that we are inherently going to be taking on a more international perspective, and also all of our offices kind of keep us in check, and because I don't want Vice News to be seen as an American news organization, I want it to be an international news organization. And I can assure you that our offices in France, Mexico City, and beyond make sure that we don't take on an American hegemonic view of the world.
I'm going to ask the panel another question, but then afterwards I'm going to invite the audience to ask questions. There's microphones, I believe. Yeah, there's one right there. So if you come up and they'll take your questions, but did you have something to say, Rainey?
I just love questions.
Yeah. So the big question is money, right? And Rainey, you said before you're different than these guys, but actually in the reporting that I've done is kind of what you do makes a lot of sense. You guys get someone who believes in you to give you a chunk of money to do it, right?
It's mission driven, and sea change is correct, Danny.
You guys got a grant to do Sea Change, which was the footage you guys saw. You know, you hear the term, you know, funded, and then you'll hear the term sponsored content, and then you'll hear the term native advertising, and that's kind of a spectrum of yuckiness. I guess really good is the getting the grant from CPB, and really bad is this thing called sponsored content. But to me, it just seems like getting money to do journalism. Can you talk about the strategies your organization is using to raise money in those avenues, and if there's any issues or conflicts that you're facing in terms of taking a hunk of money from an organization to do the work that you do?
I'll try. I mean, public broadcasting really does, so PBS really does support Frontline primarily, but increasingly we are fundraising and have to fundraise. And one of the biggest strategies is, and this is a shift for us, is we're really focused on fundraising around our investigative journalism. And I mean, everybody in this room knows that there are people now coming forward to say there's a crisis in journalism. You know, something like 15 to 17,000 people have lost their jobs in the last number of years. Investigative journalism units have been shut down across the country. I'm thrilled Vice is opening one. I am so happy that some of these news organizations are making the really, really tough bet on investigative work. So we're increasingly saying we have to fundraise around our journalism, not just around our production dollars. And that's been pretty effective, and I can't talk about it publicly yet, but that has been an effective strategy for us. And it's an important one for us to really focus on. The cost that I don't see changing, which is really strong journalism, right? I don't see that precipitously going down. I do think production dollars will get more efficient. We already have, those types of dollars are going down, but journalism generation is really important and happens to also cost money, real money.
We have always had ethical dilemmas with the money that we use to fund our journalism. Mm. And whether it's car ads or clothing ads or a grant from an organization, I just think that we have to ask similar questions. And when we approach some of our stories, we're not approaching them because we received money. That's allowing us to do the stories that we wanted to do. Sea Change was a story that we wanted to do that we might not have been able to. And so we were able to find the funding for it and we went on it.
Is that going to be an ongoing strategy for you guys to?
Well, I mean, we are trying to diversify. We are trying to bring, you know, our audience in. We have subscribers. We're trying to raise our subscription. We are trying to find grants for the stories that we want to do. I think that we want to make sure that as advertising dollars fall off, that we still are able to do good journalism and serve our community.
Right. I think foundations are coming into this space. I mean, certainly we have strong foundation support from MacArthur and Park and Wincote and others who are saying that increasingly journalism matters, and again, to the point that journalism has been in crisis. I think well-meaning people are coming in aggressively to this space, especially foundations. And there can be conflicts, but sometimes not.
And we were talking at breakfast this morning, as we're educating the newsroom about what video is and what you need to do. I think, particularly at newspapers, the advertising department has not gotten the same kind of message, so they don't really know how to sell online video. And we've seen that over and over again. The example that I gave Danny was Ernie Harwell was a longtime Tiger broadcaster, beloved Tiger broadcaster, and he was also the spokesperson for Blue Cross Blue Shield. Well, he died. We did a half-hour documentary. It was going to air on the local CBS affiliate, and our advertising dudes, and it's not bad-mouthing them. It's just they didn't know how to sell it, and they went to Blue Cross Blue Shield, and they couldn't sell it. And so, and I was showing the documentary to Ernie's agent slash best friend slash lawyer, and I said, yeah, we tried to get underwritten it by Blue Cross Blue Shield, and they said no, and he was like, who did they talk to? Are you kidding me? Because he said, if I had 5 minutes in the room, I could have easily gotten this underwritten. Well, it was like, then too late. But I just don't think that they know exactly what they're selling. And so that's a really hard thing that we're dealing with, is you have this content, it's good content, it should be connected to some type of advertising in terms of just for the support in itself, and it's not happening.
As opposed to those pre-roll things that...
Well, even the pre-roll stuff. I mean, mm-hmm. There is... Most of our stuff is kind of this canned, you know, Charter One stuff. We should be selling to local advertisers. We were doing a sports kind of... two columns from the news and the Free Press were kind of talking Lions... after game and going into the next game, and we lose all the time, people. But people love the Lions; they sell out every year, and they love their Lions. We couldn't sell it, and when we did get kind of a bite from a local advertiser, it was on a trial basis. And then, because TV stations actually help produce that advertising, that those commercials, many of them have those in-house to be able to go to their local car dealer or furniture store and help them produce a very nice polished local commercial. The commercial that was airing with this was, you couldn't see it because it was so pixelated because the res was so wrong, and it wasn't entertaining or interesting at all. And so they weren't getting any bang for any buck at all. So it's trying to get those things to come together, I think.
So Jason, what's Vice's strategy for the buck?
Yeah, I mean, so just for your reference, Vice News is kind of a startup within the larger Vice organization. You know, Vice has been around 20 years now. It's often referred to as a startup. It's a very, you know, long startup. But so Vice News is in the privileged position of kind of being floated by the other more successful parts of the business. I mean, in some ways, it's kind of the traditional or, you know, old school lost leader model, where this was something that, you know, the news department was something we're very proud of and is, you know, a badge of honor on our organization, and therefore gets to spend lots and lots of money doing very expensive things that don't make any money. Of course, we'd like that to change. So we're trying to figure out, you know, what that model is, and I obviously at the beginning was lying about having figured out how to monetize news. But we do have ideas.
I waited this here this whole time.
You lied at the Columbia School of Journalism? Really? Here?
But we do have ideas, and you know, I think that is basically creating a series of special projects which are, instead of waiting for a sales department to say, hey, we could do something with Amex, or hey, we could do something with this big company, what can we make up? In which is kind of, I think, a traditional branded content model that a lot of people have been falling into. We are kind of developing series, original series, long-form documentaries, or even you know, online tools, digital online tools, for just kind of the most fantastical, value-added journalistic endeavors we could ever imagine, and then trying to shop those around and saying who will cough up the dough to put their name next to those things. And hopefully it'll work.
Yeah. What are you seeing, Andy?
Yeah, I think that's where we've seen a lot of success too, is looking at ways other to monetize other than the CPMs. I mean, the advertising departments will tell you all the time, we just need inventory, you just need to get more people watching. And that's true for the traditional straight pre-roll ads. I think when you venture into different things, when you do, not sponsored, we wouldn't do necessarily sponsored content, but sponsored shows, or you know, you can get your ad aligned with this type of content, there's some real value there. And I think if we think of, you know, if we on the newsroom side of that great divide, which I think is crumbling a little bit, but you know, if you can see through to the advertising side, the folks on the advertising side are doing something similar to what we've done over the years, which is contract a lot. And they're doing a lot more, you know, with fewer people. Sound familiar? Like, so they're, you know, I think when we can help and say, hey, here's an idea, this is how we're gonna put this together, what do you guys think? You know, that's where I think, you know, there could actually be a good amount of success, is when the news side sort of takes some of that ownership and says, okay, we got it, here you go, try this, and helps them along.
Great. I'll open up the questions, the floor. Any questions? Yeah. And just line up on these microphones, we'll take them as they come. Yeah.
I've got one. My name is Grant Slater, and up until a few months ago, I made a video for public radio in Los Angeles. And I have a question about views. So we're talking about maybe not a lot of people view our videos, but it's not for lack of people viewing video on the internet. So I was wondering if you guys had any thoughts about what we can learn from places where people actually do watch video. So do we have something to learn from like the Epic Mealtimes of the world, or the Jenna Marbles, or the ASAP Science? And if you don't know who those people are, then why not?
I was only leaning in because I really don't know who those people are.
Yeah. Oh my God, I'm so relieved.
Nor can I answer why I don't.
Do you guys know?
Yeah, marbles.
Okay,
yeah,
you will, do. Of course, right?
Well, no, I mean, I think there, you know, generally there's something that, you know, that we talked about this before. I rambled about this before, but there's a sort of an authenticity or a personality that you get connected with, and that you feel like, okay, I get it. These people are speaking directly to me, and in a voice that I understand, and in a way that I want to consume this. And what I think we can learn from them is, they look for immediate feedback and for response, and they get that, and they interact with their audience in a very different way that all of these newsrooms generally do. And they can do that, and they are their personality, they are their brand. We are large brands, and that's a lot trickier. That, I think, is the biggest sort of takeaway for me.
I guess, I mean, maybe one quick answer to that would be, what did your audience come to your site expecting, or what did they come there for? For us, we have the benefit of being largely video-led for a long time, so people are expecting video, and that's what they're there looking for, and they're ready to do a deep dive into those things. So maybe
that's
us
too, right?
Yeah,
because
right.
We get most of our traffic is right when we released a new big film, so people still expect us to have these big opus films, and they come, in the hundreds of thousands and a couple of million, and it grows, and people come increasingly. So it is like, you guys, the expectation is we're going to have high quality, big stories, things that make sense. But now we're trying to think about the more authentic voice of our reporters. So that's where we're trying to push the envelope, and it's working really well for us. So we'll see where that takes us.
I think the thing with newspapers, and you can jump in here if you want, is that, every day the newspaper comes out, it's either landed on, you use this analogy, why don't you say it, because I thought it was brilliant, and I was like, I'm going to steal it, I'm not going to steal it in front of all these people.
That's pretty good.
I think we have to go to our audience. This comes from social media. I think we have to go to our audience, and we go to where they are, and we can't be expecting them to show up to our websites. In the same way that we don't print 200,000 or 500,000 or 1 million copies of our newspapers and then leave them in our building and say, come on,
come and get it.
We're right downtown, or we're right in the suburbs of some newspapers. Come to us and find. No, we need to go out. And so I think that it's a matter of changing a lot of the blame. I think we can take on ourselves and in our own newsrooms. And if we are expecting our audience to really enjoy and get our video, shouldn't we expect every person in our newsroom to at least understand that we have video?
Be an advocate for your work. Get it out. There is an audience. You just have to find it. And it's a little bit more effort after you've produced it to find those people. And the example I gave to Danny this morning was, we did a documentary about the 40th anniversary of Aretha Franklin's song Respect hitting number one. And, the Pistons were in the playoffs. So that, on that day it published, was like non-existent on the website. They had lost, and they were still at the top of the homepage. And so that week, I wrote a press release, and I just started contacting every Aretha Franklin fan site and every Northern Soul and anybody that loved any kind of Detroit kind of retro throwback music, and just sent them that link and said, hey, we did this. That's what you got to do if you're going to invest the time.
Mm-hmm. And we do that too, aggressively. And our audience people are all journalists themselves, so they're all obsessively reading. So they're really hooked into all these different communities you can now hook into. It's kind of amazing how you can build like that. And that's new for us. We're a couple of years into that, and it's amazing.
And
it's different.
It seems like a lot, especially when all of our newsrooms are shrinking. But when you consider that you might have spent weeks or months on a project to then say, okay, I'm moving straight on to the next one without delivering it to your audience, maybe you should spend a few more days on it.
Absolutely. Next question.
Yeah, hi there. My name is Adam Veltz. I'm an independent writer, filmmaker, photographer based here in New York. My question is around visual style, particularly camera work. And I'd really appreciate it if a range of you could kind of riff on this theme. Because we often hear the audience in general in the world is becoming more visually sophisticated. We're bombarded with more images, and people read stuff faster and they read stuff different. But it seems to me, with the explosion of web journalism, I trained in the early 90s, I shot on film, we cared about every little millimeter of the frame, we cared about composition, we graded things as beautifully as we could, even on sort of news stories. And so, I watch Frontline and I'm like, oh, it's like this huge relief, and I'm sort of basking in the glory of a properly graded, wonderfully
awesome.
Shot sort of thing.
My
wife
point.
Jokes because I turn down all the lights and hey, it's Frontline. But then, most of what I watch on news sites is horrible by my standards. Really, truly awful. And it's kids with DSLRs
yes,
that just
know
the green mode, and so my question is, am I just an old fart, you know, at 40 years old, who once would, you know, never really happen again, except perhaps on Frontline, or, let's give Vice some credit. Sometimes you guys do some beautiful stuff, but most of the time, you know,
some
never mind. The question is, does it really matter? Am I getting hung up or whatever on something that is actually irrelevant? In other words, is the so-called visual sophistication of the audience allowing it to see through what I would call awful camera work and horribly graded, awfully compressed stuff? Or is the audience actually demanding more visually sophisticated, more technically competent imagery? And the news sites just haven't seen that, and they're missing the boat. I'd really love you guys to riff on this and talk about this a little bit more.
Well,
I think that the audience does demand it. I just think that sometimes story trumps perfection, and sometimes, you know, I feel like we've been doing video for forever, and it kind of drives me nuts when people act as if video is something new. But for a lot of our staff, in comparison to how long they've been doing still photography, video is kind of new, and they make some kind of beginner mistakes. But sometimes that's a learning experience, and we move on, and the story justifies it. So we learn, and we're getting better. And if you look at where we are now versus 2 years ago, I think that there's been a huge difference. And I think that if you look at where we are 2 years from now, I think that that is only going to accelerate.
I mean, actually, I'm a big observer of online video. I love your comments. I can only go down from here. However, I do think that what I've been observing, and this is like from the New York Times, Vice, all these places, are doing better and better visual storytelling. I think you're right, like 2 or 3 years ago, I think I was with you, I was just devastated, by the way, and the whole Kodak example of, you know, convenience over quality, and I was just paranoid. But now I'm seeing people move aggressively into the visual space, and it's quite exciting. I mean, I can't believe some of the stuff I'm seeing, and especially still photographers who are picking up video cameras, or they're shooting in 5D, or whatever they're using. It's just beautiful. So some of the stuff, I'd love to send you some of it, because I think there's some great stuff out there that's less formal than what we do, but it is gorgeous, some of it. So I think it's actually going to move in the direction towards that, would be my guess. Still raw and authentic, but beautifully told.
So people are not wasting money on a good camera person,
no.
In other words. You
no,
don't think
I don't
it's a
think
waste
so.
Of
you
money.
And I can talk after, no.
Okay, yeah, okay, all right.
Kathy? Well, one thing, Heather. Well, the five pieces I showed you, I think they were all beautifully shot and told.
Yeah, you guys did a great job.
Yes.
Is that what you were talking about? I thought you meant the report. The report was really well shot.
Actually,
I'll pay you later. I'll pay you later, Andy.
The great.
That is the best shooting ever, you guys.
So, Kathy, what do you think about that?
When we first started shooting video, I mean, we had our learning curve, but we really, it was out of necessity that we had to kind of really think about composition, because we were taking frame grabs, you know, and it was really hard to do both. Now, if the story warrants it, we say, okay, we're going to give you time to do stills, and then we're going to give you time to do video, so that they can think a little bit differently when they're shooting. But we needed it to be, you know, hold a front page for us. So we were thinking very cinematically about the way that we were shooting. You know, the guy who did Packard was nominated for a National Emmy for cinematography because mm-hmm. he's a really, really beautiful shooter. And I think our staff, all of them, are kind of trying to hit this very high bar that we've set. And in terms of the bad stuff, you know, I know that Andrew's going to be doing this. We're doing this. We're trying to train people up and say, okay, mm-hmm. you got to use a tripod, or maybe you don't if you're Vice, but you have to. They're in the moment. I get it. You don't need to use a tripod when you're in the moment.
God, it would get you in trouble.
But you know, the one shot wonders that you're like, oh my God, can you just sequence, please? Give me wide, medium, tight, you know, things like that. The one hope that I had, I judged the National Press Photographers TV contest last week or the week before, and we saw a piece from, oh God,
isn't that terrible? I can't remember who it's from. But it was a newspaper.
You can go with the Washington Post if you like.
It was Washington Post.
just by default.
And the other judge said, is this the level of work that's being done at newspapers? And I said, yeah, at some newspapers. He goes, oh boy, we're in trouble. And I thought, okay, good. Because, you know, we were looking at the really good TV news stuff. These are really talented journalists telling really incredible stories and really visually sophisticated stories as well. So I think that we're getting over that hump. The problem is you're going to see the reporters start doing it, and it's going to go again.
Right.
Jason, defend yourself.
There are two clips that I show to new producers that I work with, and one is from a film called Tell Them Who You Are. It's about Haskell Wexler, and it opens with, you know, his father asking him, hey, Dad, so what's going on here today? And then Haskell lays into him and is like, you know, fuck that bullshit. I don't do that kind of documentary where you tell us what's going on here. Look, something's going to happen here today. Either you're going to get it on film or you're not. And if you do, great. And if you don't, tough shit. So that was lesson one. Lesson two was from an old documentary about Roger Corman, in which a first-time director is talking about working with Corman and says, on working with directors of photography, ask them how long to make it great. Then ask them how long to make it good. Then ask them how long to get an image and get the image. certainly we strive to have beautiful pictures, and I've actually, it's ironic, just last week was dealing with a group of German journalism students who came over to Vice, and they were just kind of like, why do you make war and all this stuff look beautiful and like skateboarding videos and like with your excellent, very expensive cameras and your, you know, surfer director of photographies, directors of photography and things like that. So it's hit or miss. Like one day we're making it too pretty, another day it's too rough. But I guess, before I was a J. Jonah Jameson style editor in chief, I'm a field producer and a shooter myself. And so I've worked in different production scenarios from, you know, setting up to interview Martin Scorsese, which is the most high pressure thing ever, to being with the Hamas bomb squad. And they all require different skills and also different approaches to capturing those moments. And sometimes having some sort of journeyman director of photography in a situation where you just need to be rolling and catching this right now, not wait till magic hour, is important. And also, Vice is a place where, you know, anyone with a strong idea and a bit of ambition gets the chance to do things. And so, so sometimes that produces mixed results as people go through the learning curve, and we publish it anyway.
One of our least composed films was just a huge hit this year, was the North Korea film that we did, and people just loved that. I would be curious after if you want to tell me what you thought of that, because that was so not composed, but people just resonated with that like crazy, so that was interesting.
Sorry. The one example I always give when we're talking about quality and versus just news is the iPhone photo of the people standing on the wing of the plane in the Hudson River. It was not done with a beautiful camera with a great lens. It was done with an iPhone. It's the immediacy, it's the news. And to your point, that you're gonna have to use the tool and capture it the way you can based on what's really going on.
Yeah. And that's why I don't want you to discount small cameras too much, because I've seen a lot of times where we've had access to an interview because we have a small camera, and it's a lot less intimidating that if I'm in front of you talking to you like this and speaking to you and looking in your eyes, sometimes you'll talk to me when you're not gonna talk to this guy who's covered like this and all of his lighting crew. And we often get access to places where TV crews don't.
I mean, I guess my question is, it's not so much the small camera or the big camera. It's the question is, there's the immediacy, but then there's the faux immediacy that a lot of people seem to be using, which is just, you know, crap exposure, kid who doesn't know how to use their DSLR, you know. And some people say, well, that doesn't matter, or this is a desirable look. You know, and again, that's more my kind of question. Obviously, the wing on the, you know, the people on the wing of the Hudson, fantastic. You know,
but I take responsibility for that.
Yeah, so but if it's faux immediacy, maybe we should be having an ethics discussion than a photography discussion.
Right. Yeah, that's a good question. Let's move on to the next one. Thank you.
Hi, my name is May Ryan. I'm a video journalist for The Guardian. I've been a big fan of Vice for a long time, but I have been disappointed by how many women correspondents there are. And I really
enjoy... There's too many women correspondents, you're saying.
What?
You're saying there are too many. You're disappointed.
There's too many. I really enjoyed the HBO series, but the whole first season there wasn't a single woman who was the lead correspondent. There's one in the second season, but I would just be curious to know more about that process and why there haven't been as many females in front of the camera.
I don't have a good answer for that. Someone's waving their hand wildly over there. I think they have the answer. Actually, I guess I would say in terms of HBO season 2, I would counsel patience, because there are many more where that one came from. And Vice News, we have a variety of women correspondents. A piece we just put up today called Love, Serve, and Surrender, which was the first of our investigative pieces into basically the foster home from hell, is hosted by Juhi Baig, who I also went down to El Salvador with this past fall. She's pretty great. It's a question that comes up, and I understand, and I certainly understand it in terms of precedent, but it's something that is just being changed organically and actively. You know, it's not like we have gone out and actively decided to hire a new crop of women with different, or correspondents with different chromosomes. But it is happening, and it is part of what we're doing. Actually, when I was here at the career fair, I had someone complain that our female correspondents were too smart. She was saying that they seemed really, really smart, but they didn't seem like people you would want to hang out with. And I was like, I was kind of confused. I was like, okay, so now I feel like sometimes there's no pleasing everyone. You know, like, it's like, I'm sorry that the women who we have on camera are intelligent. I will try and make them more down.
Those smart women.
Wow, great. Tough job.
Next question.
Hi, my name is Roy Klebin. I'm one of the video students here in Dew's class. You guys seemed collectively a little hesitant to talk about profit potential for video, so I wanted to talk about the approval of production budgets for videos. Do you see a trend of financial modeling where you kind of see maybe a $50,000 budget thing will have a high rate of return, so you focus on those size things, or do you just get sold from an editorial point of view on the potential audience of something and scramble as best as you can to get the budget for it?
You guys should.
So I don't have a per story budget. I have a annual budget, and we just move it as we need to. Mostly you're talking about resources, and that's why we have a team. You know, we do have a daily newspaper that's printed and requires images. And so whenever we have a small team, whenever anybody's working on a long-term project, that means that somebody else is picking up their slack. But we all know that, that's how we sort of equalize. We all sort of take care of each other so that the other person can do those long-term projects. We try to make the calls as we need to as for what projects we want to pursue, but we don't really have like a per story budget.
Yeah, I would say it's resources too. So for the example, when I was at the Post, the first and 17, to keep coming back to this thing, I was hesitant at first. I was actually pretty hesitant at first. And the video journalist, Brad Horn and Jane Orenstein, who edited, and John Forsyth, who's my deputy, they all were really gung-ho about this, and I was more skeptical. What they wanted to do was really embed with this team for an entire season, which is, you know, maybe 4 months. So, like, they'd both really be off the street for 4 months working on this thing, and I was really like, oh, I don't think we can do that. It's not going to make sense. And it was sort of a leap of faith that let's just do it and it'll be fine, it'll work out and see how it goes. But, you know, in theory, let's do it. And I think the proof is in the pudding that, like, it showed, wow, we can do it and we can develop an audience that comes back for this thing. And so sometimes you just have to roll the dice.
We're running short on time, so a couple more questions, and I want to get everyone in, but these are great.
Hi, my name's Yvonne Liao. I'm the director of video for Digital First Media's Project Thunderdome for about 4 more days. this is a great panel, and actually it's been really fascinating to see the evolution of video. For us, like, we've really been thinking a lot about interactive video, so working with designers and developers, playing with drones. I mean, you see virtual reality being talked about. And so I'm kind of curious, I haven't really heard that from any of the panelists today, is like how much of the experimentation that's happening in your newsroom does involve interactive video? Are you thinking about hiring animators, illustrators, motion graphic designers? Like, video doesn't have to be confined to being on location and shooting. I think visual storytelling is so much broader than that. What are you guys doing to kind of think about that next edge of video journalism? And yeah, how's it going?
We're hiring in that area. We're really aggressively looking for people, by the way. And I'm saying that loud and clear because we really are looking for those people to come inside our newsroom. We already have hired an amazing guy who's an interactive designer, and he's literally changed us from the inside out. So we're aggressively moving into that space, and it's part of a big exploration we're doing into interactive video. And we've done a few pieces, and I think they're really strong starts to that. I can send them to you. They're cool, and they're like beginning ideas of what we could do. And we really want to move into that space if we can. Not to replace what we do, but I'm so curious about it, and I'm so I really want to move into that space. So a bunch of us feel that way at Frontline, so we're doing it.
Fantastic.
You guys?
The post-it. Oh, sorry.
Oh, we have some drones.
The Post has a number of animators and illustrators, and I think it's a really important piece of what we do. We don't have drones because there's not a lot of area you can fly drones in DC.
Sure.
They're sensitive about that.
It sort of wrangles a lot of people.
We have a deep need for developers, and we're trying to expand the developers within our newsroom. I think it's going to take some time for us because we have some major pressing needs for them, but we are trying to integrate developers better into our newsroom so that we can accomplish projects like that and interactive graphics. Right now, we're sort of limited to trying to use third-party tools.
And for us, it's an area, you know, we had layoffs just recently, and two of them were in the graphics department, in what's called our multimedia arts department. And so we need to kind of rebuild and refocus whether or not we'll be able to as we're dealing with money. But it is, it's something that we only do in very, very special ways and only maybe do once or twice a year on something really big. But I think that there's an opportunity to do it in the smaller forms along the way. We just right now don't have the resources to kind of allocate towards that.
Great. Okay, a couple quick questions because some of our panelists have to catch flights.
Yes.
Hi, Lauren Mack from the Tao Center. We have a couple questions via Twitter sent to our hashtag Tao Talk. The first one comes from Notorious Ruse, who asks, in general, how many folks do you have on your video production teams?
For me or for Vice or for all of us?
For all of you, I guess, if you just go down the line in general, because I know it changes.
We vary from very small teams, like one person literally working with an editor, to teams that can range from 2 to 5, generally speaking, per big film.
We have 12 photographers, one dedicated video editor, me, I'm about a half a video editor, and I think that we're coming around to realizing that even though we've done a lot as a really small, efficient team, it's time to really invest in really good storytelling and really good storytellers if we're going to keep pushing this forward.
Really, for us, it depends on the story. So, a medium range video may be one person. Our long form stuff may be 2 or 3. Usually the videographer is actually shooting and editing and sometimes doing the reporting on it too.
It'll sound like a dodge, but it's actually very hard for me to figure that out. Across the company, there are more than 1,000 employees, and we're so video-centric. That's a healthy number of them. But specifically, the Vice News team combined with the HBO team, which kind of feed the same pool, probably about 50 in New York between producers, associate producers, editors, things of that nature. And yeah, I'm not even sure internationally across news.
Yeah, and I'll take the same dodge. It's hard to calculate because there are people dedicated to video at the Post, and I can't speak for them anymore. There are people dedicated to the Post, to video, and then there are plenty of other people in the newsroom, reporters and photographers and others, who also participate in video, which is actually adds pretty significantly.
And the second question comes from Stephen R. Powell to Jason. He would like to know, Vice uses graphic imagery often, most broadcasters don't. Is that a function of the internet as a medium?
I would say yes, you can get away with a lot more. And again, I think that broadcast news paradigm that we talked about before, where you are trying to reach the, you know, the biggest audience possible, and graphic images tend to make people change the channel, which is not what you want to happen. So yeah, it's an important part of our storytelling. We don't do it just to be gratuitous. We do it to help people understand the reality of the situations we're talking about.
And the last one I'll do from Twitter is from @DavidClinchNews, and he wants to know, what is the role of UGC video for news video strategy? So user-generated content.
I mean, we use it when it makes sense. We've used it on a couple of big projects before. It's really been interesting for us. And when it makes sense, I mean, certainly we're seeing, even in Ukraine and Crimea, a lot of the video is taken from what I would call user-generated, I think people who are actually filming on the scene next to our reporter. So we're using that video as well. So I think a lot of video now is being filmed by people who are there on location, and we're using it if we can vet it and make sure it's real. And that's really the key for us, is really the vetting process and making sure it's authentically what they say it is. So that usually helps when you're standing right next to the guy doing it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The same here. I mean, it's just making sure that what you're seeing is really what
it's
it
real.
Is.
Yeah. The vetting process is hard in that way.
Last question, because I know you've been waiting a while. Sorry, we got to cut it off there because the evenings run long, but shoot.
I have a question about sort of video discovery. I'm assuming that you guys are sort of robust video consumers and watchers of the industry, being that you're, you know, at the forefront of it. And I'm just curious about, you know, like there's a lab at Columbia that's doing some pretty interesting research on sort of like cataloging and searchable video. And I know there are, you know, some tools out there for viewers to discover video without having to visit your site or be on your social channels. I'm just curious, like from your own sort of consumption habits and or, you know, what you'd like your readers to have as tools, what are you excited about or what do you sort of wish existed, be it, you know, well-curated video DJs or tools for discovering video without having to be dedicated viewers for your site?
Video DJs, I like that.
Yeah,
cool. How about that?
Yeah, the idea of curation is actually really important. I think as there's so much more thrown at you, and when you look at Twitter, like there is so much, it's a constant stream. And having someone who you trust who says like, oh, check this out, you should really look at this video. I value that more than anything. Yeah.
And that's what I would say too. I mean, I watch what my friends have already, if they think that it's worth 20 minutes, odds are pretty good that I will too. And so I know that that's how I consume. And that's how also I think that we need to think about how we distribute.
Yeah, I mean, I oftentimes will, if I've heard about it or read about it, or if I'm looking to be inspired, you know, I might do, you know, I might actually Google best web video of 2013. Then I'll get the cat, but then I might stumble on somebody who has decided to curate, you know, the best kind of medium form or the best experimental or whatever it might be. So, and then I just kind of dive in from there. I go to the Webby website a lot for inspiration and for to find cool stuff going on.
Jason?
Come up with something.
Again, I second the word of mouth sort of thing. You know, it's just kind of like you have those friends who go see every band, and then you have people like me who will wait till everyone else tells you what band you should go see. Or,
until you get Rickrolled, then you actually.
All right, well, very good. Well, with that, I want to thank our panelists, Rainey Aronson, Danny Golowski, Kathy Kalaszewski, Jason Mojica, and Andy Pergam. One more thing, the report is available at videonow.taucenter.org. Watch it, you'll see all their lovely faces again in bright, bold Technicolor. Thanks for coming out on a Monday night, and we'll see you guys soon, right? Good night.
Thank you.